Hallelujah. Turn with me over to Psalms 37. Hallelujah. You know, I was speaking with the Lord here the other morning, and my heart's cry has been to be a delight to Him. That's what I've been praying is God, what is your desire for my life? What delights you about me? And, you know, He began to talk to me about walking in His way. That gives God great delight when we walk in His ways.
Yes.
And, or I should say His way, because there's only one way for our lives.
Right. Amen.
You know, God, I can't walk in Glenn's way. You know, I can't walk in Helen's way. I've got to walk in the way that God has for me. And He will have those moed times, those times that He will cause us to intersect with moments of time that benefit our lives, that help us along, that pick us up when we fall down. And He began to talk to me out of this scripture here in Psalms 37:23. It says, the steps of a good man are ordered of the Lord, and He, God, delights
yes.
in His way.
Yeah.
And not in God's way, but in our way.
Yes.
He delights in our way. Why does He delight in our way? Because He made it good.
Yes.
Amen.
He made our way good.
Amen.
Now, do we stumble and fall? Do we have trip-ups? Sure we do. Do you think the devil, just because you got born again, the devil's going to just leave you alone? I don't think so. Because you see, his whole mindset is to kill, steal, and destroy.
Right.
If he can kill your finances, if He can destroy your relationships, you know, if he can steal your joy, then He's delighted. Well, I can't even say that because I don't think the devil has a happy day in his life.
Yeah, right.
But God delights when we walk in His ways.
Right.
Why? Well, the first part of the verse says that. It says, our steps are ordered of Him. Now, that word orders is a really neat word. It means prepared.
Yes.
God has steps, or He has a way prepared for us. And like I just said, you know, we can't walk in each other's ways. You know, we get over into covetousness a lot because we want somebody else's life. We want what somebody else has. And we get so focused on what somebody else has, you know, their ministry or their occupation or their status in life or whatever. We get so desirable, we desire that to such a degree that we hate our own life.
Right.
And see, that displeases God because He's made a way for us. And it's up to us to seek Him concerning our ways because He's already
yes.
prepared a way.
Right.
Turn with me over to Genesis, the first chapter. We're just going to look at some scriptures. I like looking at scriptures. They tell truth, and they don't get sidetracked.
Amen.
Amen. The first chapter of Genesis, we're going to start in the beginning. Hallelujah. Verse 27, so God created man. He just said that He said, let us make man in our image according to our likeness. Verse 26, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the air and over the cattle and over all the earth, over every creeping or moving thing or everything that has breath on the earth. So God created man in His own image. In the image of God created him, male and female. He created them. And God blessed them. Now I want you to notice something here. At this point in time, Eve was not created.
Yes.
I'll let that sink in a little bit. But yet, God had a plan.
Yes.
God had a plan. And we read, you know, over the second chapter where he took aside, it says a rib, But if you go to the original Hebrew, it actually says a side. It took a side out of man. What side? He took the feminine side out of man. And he separated man and woman, but yet he always considered them one unit.
Yes.
He created them one unit. And he said he created him in his own image. For God created them male and female, he created them. And then God blessed them and said to them. Now, I said this morning, and I'm going to repeat it here again tonight. When God says something, it's a done deal.
Yeah.
As far as God is concerned,
yes.
It's a done deal.
Amen. Hallelujah.
And so God said something here. And this is the first time, and those places of first mention in the Bible are very important. This is the first time God talked to his man. So what he said to his man was very important.
Yes.
It's very important. It's his first word to man. Now he breathed life in him. And when he breathed his life in him, when he breathed his very nature into man, that said something in itself. But actual words he said, this is what he said to Adam, to said to his man, be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth, subdue it, have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the air and over every living thing that moves on earth. Now, when he was talking to Jesus in the Holy Ghost before, he said, this is how we're going to create him and this is how he's going to function. So when man was created and began to breathe and move and walk, then God said something to him. And just like Jesus said to them in that boat, the disciples in that boat, we're going to the other side. That's where they were going. And it doesn't make any difference what kind of storms come up, what kind of smoke screens come up, what kind of dust the devil stirs up.
Amen.
If God has said something, it's a done deal.
Amen.
And see, that's why Jesus, when he hung on that cross, you know, he said, it is finished. What is finished? The curse that was put on man that kept him out of what God told him in the beginning.
Amen.
God didn't take his word back. I don't read any place in the Bible where God took his word back, that blessing back.
Right.
Never did it. It's always been there. And when Jesus said it's finished, that means the curse that was on man is finished.
Amen.
But man had to make a choice then to walk in God's ways again. He had to receive Jesus. He had to, take salvation, and he had to then seek God and find out what God has to say. You know, Pastor says it all the time, you know, that Jesus was the Word made flesh, but we're the flesh being made the Word.
Oh, hallelujah.
We're being made what God said we are. God has said something about you, and it behooved you to find out what he says about you.
Right.
I'll tell you what, you'll find that it's nothing but love, even when it's correction.
Yes.
I started crying to God the other day, and I said, God, I love your correction. I love your correction. Sometimes it's the hardest thing I go through mentally, because when God starts to correct you, the devil's always wanting to chime in.
Yeah. Yeah.
He's always wanting to say, see, you're not perfect. You can never be perfect. You can't live up to what God's told you. You'll never have what God says you'll have.
Right.
Devil, you're a liar.
Right.
Amen.
Yeah.
But when God corrects me, that's telling me that he loves me enough to get me back on his path. That's why David said, your rod and your staff, speaking of the great shepherd,
yes.
Your rod and your staff, they're a comfort to me.
Yes.
Because, you know, his rod is there to pull me back on the path when I get out into the bushes and
thank
the briars and the stickers and the thorns.
Thank
I
you.
Get over in the curse.
Right.
His rod will pull me back in. I mean, his
yeah.
staff will pull me back in.
Yeah.
His rod will thump the enemy if he has to. But his rod and his staff, they comfort me. And that's, his correction is great comfort to me.
Yes.
Because I know he's heading me someplace.
Yes.
He's keeping me on his path because his path is the fullness of what he spoke to me before the foundations of the earth.
Thank you, Lord.
So we see here that God created his man. He said something to his man. He blessed his man. He gave him instructions. And he says, you know, see, I've given you, he begins to show him everything that he's given to him.
Yep.
He begins to tell him how you have authority over the birds of the air and the fish of the sea.
Yep.
How you can take authority over all of creation.
Yep.
And I believe when God walked with Adam during the cool of the day, he was just revealing more of himself to Adam.
Yeah.
I tell you, the more time you spend with God, the more you walk with God, the more you see about him.
Yes.
You know, Jesse Duplantis said this, and I thought that was great. He said, when he took his trip to heaven, he saw these angels flying around the throne saying, holy, 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 holy. And he thought to himself, for all of eternity, they've been saying that, and into all of eternity they're going to say that.
Yes.
Why can they say, he asked the angel, he's with, excuse me, why can they say that with such great assurance and great praise in their hearts, you know, and the angel told him, he says, Jesse, you don't understand, every circle they make, every round they make, they see another facet of God.
Hallelujah.
You know, and all through eternity, we're going to see another facet of God.
Yeah.
Here on this earth, we can see another facet of God.
Hallelujah.
Every day, several times a day,
yeah.
God reveals himself to us. And he begins to show us who we are in him. We begin to see who we really are, not who mama said we was, and Uncle Fred says we was, and Aunt Sally said we are, and our teachers, you know. I had a teacher one time say to me, that's the stupidest thing I ever heard. And you know, it crushed me. And so I went home and told my mom, well, if anybody knows my mom was at the office first thing the next morning. You know, but you know, people are going to say all kinds of things to you, and the devil will see to it that he can conform you, mold you into destruction.
Yeah, right.
And you were not made for destruction.
Yeah, yeah.
You were made for success.
Yeah.
You were made to fulfill your part,
yeah.
Give your supply,
yes.
In the body of Christ to bring about the kingdom of God,
yeah.
So Jesus can come back. Amen?
Yeah.
But here he said, He tells man everything he's given him. He instructs him on what his purpose and his job was. And it says that in verse 31, then God saw everything that he had made, and indeed it was very good. God didn't say very good until he made man.
Amen.
Everything was good. But when he made man, it all of a sudden became very good.
Hallelujah.
And so God made man for good. God made man for very good, because that's what God said about him. When God breathed his life into Adam, he not only breathed life into Adam, he breathed your life.
Yes.
He breathed your life.
Amen.
Into Adam.
Yes.
And because it says here that after 6 days of doing everything he did, on the seventh day, he rested. Why did he rest? Because he'd already spoke your life in place. He spoke the life of the very last person born on this earth before the end comes.
Amen.
He spoke in that one breath, God created mankind. That's why he blessed him before he even took Eve out of him. He blessed them because he was blessing man and woman. He was blessing them with one blessing, one breath,
right.
Clear down to where you and I are today,
yeah.
And on into the future.
Yeah.
So God has prepared everything beforehand.
Yeah.
Turn with me over to Hebrews, the fourth chapter. I love the word, so I have lots of scripture. I just kind of want to read a portion of this scripture. I mean, Hebrews 4 is fabulous.
I love it.
Read Hebrews 4. But in Hebrews 4, 3, it says, For we who have believed do enter that rest, the same rest that God had. When the sixth day was over, with that seventh day he rested because everything was completed. Clear down through Jesus' birth, death, and resurrection.
Yes,
down into your life, it was all done. It was all completed.
No.
And so he could rest. He's still resting.
Yes.
God's not worried about your life.
No.
Okay. God's not worried that it's not going to turn out right. He knows the end.
Amen.
He made the end.
Yes.
He created the end.
That's
us. Well, what did God say to us? Go back to Genesis 1.
Right.
Your life isn't working like it should. Go back to Genesis 1. What did God say?
Yep.
Take dominion. Yes. Pastor Mike preached it this morning. Take dominion in your sphere of influence.
Yes.
You tell your neighborhood what kind of neighborhood it's going to be.
Right.
You don't let the police report tell you what kind. You don't let the newspaper tell you what kind of neighborhood you live in. You tell your neighborhood what kind of neighborhood you live in.
Yes.
See, that's your Garden of Eden. God said guard it.
Amen.
God said take dominion over it.
Yes.
That's your dwelling place. And you can take dominion over it. Your finances, take dominion over it.
Right. Amen.
It's created from substance of the earth. You take dominion over
Lord.
It. See, you've got, like Michael said, you know, about him, you know, crying and whining to God about, you know, we need to be delivered from cigarettes. God said, you big baby, stop. Well, some of us just need to stop the destructive behavior in our life and hear what God has to say about it.
Amen.
And do what God's telling us. He's got the way prepared.
Yes.
He knows the way we need to go. He knows the adjustments we need to make. But we're not going to know them unless we spend time with him.
Amen.
Amen. We know his ways.
Yes.
So he says here, 4:3, it says, so I swore in my wrath they shall not have rest. Now listen, although the works, what works?
Yes.
What God did back in Genesis. The works were finished from the foundation of the world. Your life is finished. Every day of your life is a page.
Amen.
Every day of your life is a page out of your book.
Amen.
And what, you know, God's already wrote in that book.
That's right.
That day.
Amen.
You know, when I get up in the morning, I give my day to God.
Yes.
I say, God, this is the day that you have made. I love that scripture when you really look at all the words in it.
Yes.
It says, this is the day that God has extravagantly made for me.
Amen.
That's why I can rejoice and be glad in it. See, there's no failure. When I get up tomorrow morning, there's no failure in my day. Well, I fail, probably so. But it's not in God's plan.
Right.
God's plan in my life is to hear what he says and walk in his way. And when he goes, ah, 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 we stop.
Okay.
Most people don't hear what God's saying because they're too busy planning what they're going to do about a situation that they don't like.
Right.
And then they devise, that's right, Bart, it's not rest, they devise, they go to work. And I speak from experience. They go to work planning how they're going to get out of that situation.
Yes.
Well, I can say this or do that. No, but what if they say this? Well, then I'll have to say this and that.
Yes.
Well, yeah, but what? Well, I'll have to do that. And 10 minutes into all of this, you're going, ah, 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 ah. You know, your brain is all, you're frustrated before you even get into the situation because you know how bad it's going to be. No, no, no. I'm having to learn. I'm 64 years old, and I'm having to learn like Michael's having to learn at age 40, whatever. He's having to learn.
42.
He's having to learn that you've got to stop.
Amen.
When you are presented with something that is not God, an attitude, a learned behavior that's not a good behavior, whatever it is, you've got to stop and say, God, what do you say?
Yes.
You get involved with people. God, what do you say about this situation?
Yes.
There's a lot of times that God puts people in my life that in the natural I wouldn't hang out with.
Right.
I wouldn't have, you know, lunch with them or go shopping with them or, you know, that kind of thing. He puts people in our lives that are anything like us. But if we don't take the time to say, God, why have you put that person in my life? And let God show you who they are in him.
Right.
See, that's so important with people.
Yes.
You can't, you know, judge people by books, like books by their cover. You can't, because their cover, that's just what it is.
Right.
Yeah, that's good, yeah.
Right.
It's just what it is.
Yeah.
It's everything the devil has done to them all through their life. It's all the abuse, all the broken hearts, all the broken relationships, all the wounds and the traumas of life. That's their cover. But you got to know on the inside. You know, sometimes, you know, people, you know, come into our lives that are really a mess. And you go, God, I don't even want to deal with this. Well, don't deal with it. Find out what God is saying and approach that person. You know, I've been accused a lot of times of making excuses for people. No, I'm not making excuses for bad behavior. I'll never make excuses for bad behavior. But bad behavior has a source.
Yes.
Bad behavior has a wound.
That's right.
Bad behavior has a trauma.
Yes, it does.
And when you understand that that person is who they are because of all of those things,
yes,
and they're in the process of being healed just like you are.
Thank you.
I know I've ticked a lot of people off. You know, I've upset a lot of people, and I don't intend to do it. But out of my own wounds and my traumas, I become a perpetrator. Mm-hmm. You know, if I've been wounded because somebody's betrayed me, then, you know, I don't let a whole lot of people close to me because of the fear of being betrayed again. And, you know, until we can let God work in us, of course, he'll never be finished working on us. But I think even in heaven, we're going to have to go to some classes. But you know, I think that, you know, as we let God work on us and we let God work his love in us.
Yes.
You know, you can take a dry piece of leather, you know, crack dry piece of leather, and you begin to work oil in it. You begin to work that and work that, and you bend it and you twist it and you work it and you work it. That all of a sudden it becomes soft. It actually begins to mend itself. You know, and that's what happens to us. The Bible says that the love of God has been poured into us by the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost always is represented by oil.
Amen.
You know, and he begins to pour his love in us, and he begins to bend us and twist us and rub on us and just, you know, rub that in our lives.
Thank you.
And, you know, that begins to change us. But a lot of people that you run into are in the same process you're in. God's working them over.
Yes.
God's changing them. God's taking out all of those things in them that he didn't plan to get in them. But life, they just got in them. You know, the devil saw to it that a seed of fear was planted in their heart when they were a baby. Or you know, abuse or trauma came to them as a child. You know, he's worked. See, I believe that when God spoke your destiny, it was words of spirit. Well, the devil is a spirit, and I think he has an idea of who you are in the spirit.
Yeah.
He knows who you are, and he knows who you are in the spirit better than you do.
Right.
And he will begin working on you long before you even have a clue about what life is, to see to it that you are veered from what God has called you to be. But it was finished. When God breathed his breath in Adam, your life was complete.
Amen.
The Bible says over in Galatians 2:10, I believe it is, we are complete in him.
Yes.
We're finished. We're complete in him.
Yes.
And so he's saying here that we can enter into the same rest that God enters in because it was all finished. Although the works were finished from the foundation of the world, says that he has spoken a certain place on the seventh day in this way, God rested on the seventh day from all of his works. See, and I'm learning how to rest.
Yeah.
See, when there's no peace, it's a lack of rest.
Right.
We're not resting in the finished work of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Now, do we face circumstances? Do circumstances slap us in the face? Sure they do. But that's what I'm saying. We've got to stop. Don't get so involved. Paul told Timothy, he said, He said, don't, you know, a good soldier, be a good soldier, and a good soldier does not entangle themselves in the affairs of this world. Why? Because that's exactly what happens. You get entangled.
Yes.
You get entangled. There's times that you just have to back up and say, God, how do you want me to handle this?
Right.
What do you want me to do in this situation? How do you want me to spend my time and my prayer concerning this situation? And he's more than willing to tell you.
Amen.
He's more than willing to tell you. Turn over with me. Let's see what I want. Turn over with me to Ephesians. Let's go to 2 Corinthians 9. You know, I use these scriptures in offering a lot, but I saw something in here that goes right along with what I'm saying. And then after we finish here, we're going to go to Ephesians 2. But here in 2 Corinthians, the ninth chapter, the 8th verse, it says, and God is able to make all grace abound towards you, that you always having all sufficiency in all things may have an abundance for every good. There's that word again, work. Every good work.
Yeah.
See, God has put good works in you.
Yes.
He's put a good work in you. And he's saying here, he's not just saying, and this is the way I've taught it, and it's not wrong, but I saw something deeper here than just giving into good works. I saw something that God was saying here. He says that you're going to have all grace. And what he's made you to be, you're going to have all grace. All the grace you need, all the favor you need, all the thrusting you beyond your own abilities you need. He's seen to it that he is able to make all grace abound to you. Not just trickle to you. He's made all grace abound to you. You know, when I think of something abounding, I'm thinking of something leaping toward me.
Right.
You know, I see God's grace leaping toward me. And it says that his goodness and mercy following me, but his grace is leaping forward to me. It's abounding toward me. And it says here, to make all grace abound toward you, that you always, how much sufficiency? All. And how much of the time?
Always.
He says that you always, having all sufficiency in all things, may have an abundance for every good work that's in you. God will see to it that what he's created you to be, what he's called you to be, he will see to it that you have everything you need. He'll see to it that you have houses and lands and buildings and properties, vehicles, finances, equipment. He'll see to it that the doors are open. God will see to it. You don't have to make your ministry happen. You just have to fellowship with God, walk in his ways. Let him correct you. Let him take you by hand. And he'll open every door. He'll see that everything you need, everything that needs to come to you will abound to you.
Amen.
So that you can do what he's called you to do. You never have to worry. If God says, I want you to go over there and speak to that man. I want you to say such and such. You never should have to worry. We all do. But we never should have to worry about not having the right words to say.
Right.
And sometimes we say a bunch of things and we walk away and we go, oh my God, what did I say? Did that even make sense? Sure it did. It came out of here, not out of here.
Yeah.
You know, when you flow in the Holy Ghost, sometimes your brain doesn't process it.
Yeah.
Right.
Your brain goes, what are you talking about? And it's not going through your brain, your mental process. It's coming out of your spirit. It's a God thing. And sometimes Pastor and I walk away and we say, did that make any sense? What I preached today, because to our brains it didn't make any sense. And you know, the ones that don't make the most sense to us are the ones that we get the greatest reports on.
Amen.
Because you know, God is so amazing. Like I said earlier, our paths are all different. So he's going to hear you, Glenn, hear something that I say that maybe Bridget heard the same thing I said, but it didn't process to her the same way.
Right.
Because Bridget's not living Glenn's life, and Glenn's not living Bridget's life.
Right.
And if I went around the room right now and say, you know, what have I preached thus far? You probably, however many people in here, you probably get that many answers.
Yep.
Because God is an individual God.
Amen.
And He's going to deal with you concerning your path.
Yes.
He's going to deal concerning your way that He has set you in. Praise God. Now turn with me over to Ephesians, the second chapter. Verse 10 says, "For we are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for what? Good works." It is good. It is very good. God has put a good work in you, and He calls it very good. And He's not only going to supply what you have need, He's going to keep you hooked up to the supply, because you are His workmanship created in Christ Jesus. Everything you need is in Christ Jesus that you are a part of. And He says, for good works which God, what, prepared beforehand. Woo! I'll tell you what, this was good news to me when it began to dawn on me.
Amen.
That all I have to do is listen to the King.
Amen.
All I have to do is let Him provide and protect me. All I have to do is just worship Him, be His temple, and just worship and praise Him out of my being. And when you begin to do that, He begins to talk to you.
Yes, He does.
He loves to be worshipped, not because He's an egotistic maniac, but He loves to be worshipped. And when you worship Him out of your love and your knowing that He's going to support. When I worshiped God, when Mike was going through leukemia, when I worshiped God, I worshiped Him out of the knowing that by the stripes of Jesus, He was healed. I worshiped Him out of the knowing. I was laughing. He prays for his kids the same way I prayed for them. Him and Mark. Every time they go out the door, I say, they will do the will, the plan, the purpose of God. I declare it and I decree it. And they'll live the fullness of their days, and they'll fulfill their destiny in this world.
Yes.
Because that's what God told me. See, I can have great assurance in speaking that into my children's lives because I asked Him about my children.
Right.
I said, God, why were they born? And I didn't say that out of frustration one day. Oh, God, why did they were born? No, I wanted to know. I knew long before Michael got a call from God that he was a minister. Pastor and I talked about it a lot. And then the day that God called him, John says, well, I've known that for a long time. Mike says, why didn't you tell me before now? Because that wasn't our job. Our job is not to tell our children who they are. Our job is to pray into their life who God says they are, who God made them to be.
Amen.
And when you find out what God... And, you know, my other son, Mark, when God told me what he was created for, I laughed. Because Mark was nothing in my eyes what God said he was. And he was actually operating in the opposite of what God said he was. So what did I have to do? I had to take what God said he was and begin to declare and decree over him that Mark is a man of whatever God told me, he said.
Amen.
Well, actually, God told me, he said, Mark is a man of wealth and wisdom. And I'm going, well, you got to be kidding me. You know, I think the first few years of their marriage, we had supported him. And I mean, he was anything but wise concerning finances, much less a man of wisdom and riches. But I declare that over him every day. And there was times that I wanted to just beat everything that was in him out of him. You know? And I have to say, no, God said he's a man of wealth and wisdom. And that's what he'll be. Now, when he gets there, Lord knows. But that's what God has said. And I'm not going to say anything different. And every time I every time I say something negative to that, the Holy Ghost jumps me in time. He says, are you going to side with me or the devil?
Right.
He asked me one time.
Woo.
He says, are you siding with me or the devil?
Yeah.
And I said, God, I don't want to side with the devil. He said, then what saying that over your son?
Right.
And, I had to line my words up concerning my children because the devil knew who they were, and the devil did everything he could to get them to look the exact opposite of what God said they were. And living in a small town, you heard about it. Every ball game you went to, every grocery store you went to, there was somebody who wanted to tell you all the opposing things that your children did from what God said.
All lies.
Yeah.
Ask Warner.
Yeah. He was there.
Yeah, he was there. He probably witnessed it. Of course, he didn't get involved. But anyway, that's the way the devil is. He will try to get you to see in people's life.
Right.
He'll try to get you to see in your life the exact opposite of what God says you are, because the devil wants you to line up with him, because he knows the power and the dominion and the authority that God put in man in Genesis 1.
Yes.
He was there. He heard it. Why do you think he went to work as quick as he did? Because he had to stop it.
Yeah.
He had to destroy it. But I tell you what, God was not surprised the day that Adam and Eve did what they did. He had already prepared before the foundations of the earth for Jesus to come in when the fullness of time, it says. In the fullness of time, at the right time, Jesus was born so that he, on that day, on that cross, can say, it's finished.
Right.
It's finished. The day, it's over with. I'm telling you what, there's some things on the earth right now are over with.
That's right.
Yeah. Right.
God says they are, and the news can tell you the opposite. The news can tell you all kinds of things. The media is going to tell you all kinds of things. But if you've heard what God said about what's going on,
yes,
there's no fear.
Right.
In fact, half the time I listen to the news and laugh.
Fake news.
Because they're just making this huge, this huge bad stuff. And I just laugh because I know what God told me.
Hallelujah.
I know what he, I not only read the end of the book, but I know what's happening now because I spend time with God and find out. I ask him questions.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
You got a question, ask him.
Yes.
Why are they acting that way? He'll tell you.
Yeah.
I mean, he's not going to divulge stuff to you that you go around blabbing, so don't be a blabbermouth.
Amen.
But he will divulge enough to you about a person or about a situation so that you can speak into it.
Amen.
See, your words are so important. Your words are so powerful. You are the only being that God created on the earth that has words.
Yeah.
A dog barks, a cat meows, but you've got words. You've been made in the image of God. They are creation, but you were made in the image of God. You were made in the likeness and the same kind of species that God is. You are a spirit being living in a body possessing a soul.
Yes. Yeah.
But first of all, you are a spirit.
See,
and I'm having to learn to let my spirit man have ascendancy. Let my spirit man be the first thing I listen to.
Yeah.
The first person I listen to concerning the situation.
Yeah.
And God says here, he says, you, it says here, Paul said of God, you are his workmanship.
Right.
You were created and you were formed. It's just like, building a house. You look at that house after it's built and it's beautiful, but you don't ever think about the work that went into it. You don't think about the workmen coming and digging the footings and preparing the dirt and making the pad and digging the electrical lines and digging the plumbing lines and putting it all together. You don't ever walk up to a house and say, gee, that's got good-looking plumbing under the ground. Of course, you can't see it, but You know, you don't think about those things when you're looking at this beautiful house. Well, we are a beautiful house.
Yes.
We are a part of a beautiful house.
Yes, man.
We are part of a kingdom of God. We are His workmanship created in Christ Jesus. Jesus is that beautiful being.
Yeah.
But we're in Him.
Yes.
Like a puzzle piece.
Yes.
You know, like a cog or a wheel or a nail or a pipe or a, you know, you just could go on and on and on. We've got a part. We've got a place in Him. We've got a purpose in Him. And every generation has that place and purpose in Him. And it says that we are, you know, we are stones in Him. We are parts in Him. One translation says that we are His poetry, words that He has created to make a picture. We are His tapestry, another translation says. You know, we're just a piece. You know, I'm just a piece. And you know, God begins to put people in our lives that complete that piece, that add to that piece, and we begin to function all together. That's the one thing I begin to pray about our prayer meetings that we have on Tuesday mornings and Wednesday evenings. God, make us that company.
Yeah.
Make us that one functioning voice in this earth. Make us one voice in this earth. There's, you know, we're, the Bible says over in Corinthians that we are many members, but we are one body in particular. You know, we're many members, but we're one body. We all have different functions, and we function in those functions differently than somebody else. But as we do our part, it creates a harmony. It creates those streams in the desert.
Amen.
We begin to flow in one direction. See, we as a church, as a body of people, we can be a stream in this city. We can be a stream in this county. We can be a stream in this nation, in this world. If we get in the flow, we get in the path that God takes great delight in us walking in. When we begin to rest from our works and begin to flow with Him.
Yes.
See, flowing with God is easy.
Yes.
It really is. We make it hard. We, you know, we're floating along in the tube and we say, oh, I like that over there. And we paddle over there and we get out of the flow. And God says, get back in the flow. So we get back in the flow and we, you know, it's almost like we have, what is it, ADH, whatever it is.
ADHD.
You know, we just get caught off by all kinds of stuff going around us instead of staying in the flow. And see, the devil tries to create those things out there, things that we need to fix, things that we need to take care of, we think we need to fix or take care of. You know, you can't fix people.
That's
you know, you can't really even care for people the way you need to, you think you need to care for them. You need to find out what God says to you. Because you might just be enabling that person to continue their learned behaviors that are creating havoc in their life. And so you need to hear what God says. If God says call somebody, then you call them.
Yes.
If God says don't call them, you're wanting to. Oh, I need to call them and just tell them, you know, what God is showing me. No, you need to tell them what God shows you about them when He tells you to share it.
Yes, amen.
You know, sometimes you can get ahead of yourself. I remember one incident with my brother. I asked the Lord, I said, God, this has been a long time ago. I said, God, why won't He listen to me? And He says, because you're like Peter, you cut his ears off.
Mm-hmm.
See, Peter got ahead of himself.
Yeah.
You know, Peter thought he was going to fix the problem. And all he ended up doing is cutting somebody's ear off. He says, if you'll back away, he says, I'll heal his ears and we'll make it right.
Yeah.
Sometimes we do things that we think needs to be done. That's why it says over in Romans 8 chapter that when we pray, sometimes we don't even know what we ought to pray for. That's how smart we are. And that's why He gave us the Holy Ghost, because then He prays what He wants to have prayed, not what we want prayed. And, but, you know, we need to hear what God is saying concerning situations in our life and then rest in that.
Amen.
Because if God said, He's going to do it. Amen?
Amen.
Turn over to Hebrews 13th chapter. This is one of my favorite scriptures. You probably know what I'm going to, but again, you know, it's like you can read the word 150,000 times and God show you something different. That's like those angels flying around the throne of God, crying, "Holy, holy." Every time they go around, they see another facet. Every time I read scripture, I see another depth in what God is saying in this. But he talks about here in the beginning of it, he says, let your conduct be without covetousness. Hebrews 13:5. I begin to ask God about covetousness, and I shared just a little bit about it before. And covetousness is seeing something in somebody else's life that you want.
Right.
But you don't leave it at that. Oh, I'd like to have what they have. That's really neat. I like that. I'd like to have it. You begin to obsess over what somebody else has.
Yeah.
It begins to just gnaw at you. And all of a sudden you start asking questions like, they don't really deserve that. I deserve that. You know, I've been serving God for 50-something years. And they've only been serving God for 10 years. Why did they get that and I didn't? See, and you begin to converse with yourself.
Right.
And you begin to wish that you had that and that person didn't. And you begin to wish that was your life, not their life. And you begin to obsess on that to where actually you become angry, you become bitter. You know, you shun that person, you cut them off out of your life because of this covetousness. And the Lord spoke to me, and he said there in Hebrews, it says, to make someone else's life, life's blessings, yours mentally, to the degree that you hate your life, therefore you don't live your life.
Wow.
See, that's very interesting. Because you get so obsessed on somebody else's blessings in life that you neglect to live your life.
Right.
See, like I said in the very beginning, everybody's got a different path. We're all straining together, but everybody's got a different path. Do our paths have interruptions? Sometimes, sure they do. Do our paths sometimes have loss? Yes, they do. Do our paths sometimes have failure? Yes, they do. But where is, I like that scripture over, I can't think of the scripture now. I mean, I can't think of the place. But it says, you know, it's basically, I use it this way. What are you focusing on? Are you focusing that you're hit? Or are you focusing on, I didn't get knocked down?
Come on. Amen.
I'm just kind of paraphrasing that scripture. Are you confused? You going to focus on that? Or are you going to focus on the fact that God didn't leave you in despair? You know, where's your focus? Sometimes we can get so focused on the failures and the losses and the stumblings and, you know, all the things that are in our life that we cease to live our life.
Yeah.
The life that God gave us to live.
Right. Yeah.
And so he's saying here, he said, let your conduct be without covetousness. Be content with such things as you have. For he himself has said, here again, God said something. God is saying something. I like the Amplified version. It says, be content, be enough, be satisfied. That be enough and be satisfied is my words. It says, with such things as you have. For he himself has said, he himself has said, he himself, God, has said, I will never leave you or forsake you.
Yes. Yes.
He himself has said, it's a done deal, I'm paraphrasing again, it's a done deal, it's eternal, that he will not in any way fail me, nor give up on me, nor leave me without support. God says himself, I will not, I will not, I will not. I think he's trying to get a point over.
Right.
I will not, where am I at? I lost myself here. In any degree, leave you helpless,
yeah,
nor forsake you, nor let you down. I love that song when we sing it. You're never going to let me down. Hallelujah. That's scripture. Nor will he relax his hold on me.
Yep.
Or relax my hold on you, he said. This is what God says. God's saying something to you tonight.
Yes.
You need to listen.
Yes.
It's just not Karen, Sister Karen reading something. God himself is saying.
Yes.
He says, assuredly not. Otherwise, he's made a promise here. And he's saying, absolutely no other way is going to be but my way in this. And he says that he's not going to relax. Absolutely not, he said. Absolutely not, God says. He's not going to relax his hold on you. He's not going to let you down. He's not going to forsake you. He's not going to leave you helpless. He's not going to leave you without support. Not only financially, but spiritually.
Thank you.
Amen? He's going to take care of you. Now, this is me. This is my prayer journal, so I'm teaching you out of my prayer journal. It says, I wrote here, I said, I never have to covet anyone's ministry or life.
Amen.
God has provision and grace for me.
Amen.
You don't have to covet anybody's ministry.
Amen.
You just need to find out what God has you to minister. What God is saying about you. I'm telling you, it's a done deal.
Yes, yes.
From before the foundation of the earth,
yes.
He already, even before he breathed into Adam, he prepared your life.
Hallelujah.
But once his breath was released into Adam, he released all of mankind down through the eons of time.
Yes.
He released them with a plan and a purpose.
Yes.
He released them with a path that he delights us to walk in. Because he's ordered it. He's prepared it for us.
Yeah.
And I'm telling you, you never have to worry about getting where God's taking you if you just keep following God. You ask him questions. You spend time with him. I tell you, it would have been a sad day after Pastor and I said, I do, if that's the last time I talked to him. Of course, it was days. He probably wished I didn't. But if there's no communication, there's probably not a week that goes by that I don't learn something else. You know, every facet of our life is like God's. There's so many facets in our life and heart's desires. And here a while back, I shared something with John that I would like to do or something. I don't remember what it was now. But he said, really? 47 years of marriage. Really? It was something deep in my heart that I just, all through the years, I just chewed on, but never mentioned it because it just seemed like that's not something I can have. But God's been stirring something in me. There's things in me that I didn't know was in me. I mean good things. There's a lot of bad things in me. But we're getting rid of those. We're moving those out. But you know, there's things in me that I'm discovering. First time I went to see a psychologist, she asked me the question, what about yourself do you like? And I thought for a while. I said, nothing. She says, oh, come on, Karen. There's got to be something. Something that you like about yourself. I said, no. I said, every part of my being, I detest. Because I felt like such a failure. I felt like I wasn't matching up. Of course, I was matching up to all the wrong things. But she finally says, oh, come on, Karen, there's got to be something. I said, I'm bulldog loyal. You know, I said, if you're my friend, you know, I'm loyal. I'll not betray you. I said, I'm a loyal friend. And she says, well, let's start there. How many friends do you have? I got a lot of acquaintances, you know. But, you know, and she began to talk to me and begin to dig and begin to make me start thinking. You know, why didn't I have a lot of friends? Why didn't I like people? I told God one time, I said, "You're a funny man." Of course, he's not a man, but I said, "You're real funny making me a wife of a pastor. I don't even like people." And since then, I've learned to love people. And again, it's because you've got to see who God made it to be, not who you think.
Right.
You can't judge,
right,
like I said before, people by their cover.
Right.
Because that's just what it is.
Right.
And, you know, God is working in all of us. I don't know, probably everybody in here, if I asked you to raise your hand, you'd probably do it, have gone through just mental calisthenics lately. I mean, the devil just working your brain over,
amen,
trying to tell you you can't, you won't, you never will.
Yeah.
You know, and you know, you're not ever going to get past this. You're never going to be normal. You're never, you know, he just goes on. Well, look, I don't want to know what the devil's idea of normal is.
Right.
You know, his opinion on normal doesn't exist. He doesn't know what it is. But you know, God's been working in us a lot of, don't be so quick to think, oh, that's just the devil. No. God's working things out of you.
Yes.
And sometimes it takes a circumstance. Again, I can just use myself. But I remember here several years ago, an incident happened in a family situation. And I got so angry. I mean, angry. That the people in the house next door came out to see what was going on. I mean, it was angry. And when I got through doing what I was doing, I pulled my car out of the driveway and I stopped at the stop sign and I called Pastor and I said, "You better pray for me. I'm so angry, I'm either going to have a stroke or a heart attack." I said, "You better pray." Because I was so angry. You know, the devil didn't do that to me. God just said, "We need to deal with this right now."
No.
Sometimes the switch will get flipped because we need to see something we need to deal with.
Yeah.
You know, you can't blame people for your fit of carnality.
Right.
People don't make you lose your temper.
Right.
People don't make you angry.
Right.
You know, there's something in you that needs to be dealt with.
Yeah.
And a lot of times those angers and those things flare up in us, and God's saying, "There it is. You like that?" I mean, he's not making fun of us, but he said, "Do you like this?" "No, I don't like this, God." "Then let's deal with it."
No.
Yeah.
Let's deal with it.
Lord, thank you.
And so a lot of times, you know, God reveals our weaknesses to us,
yes,
because we need to realize we can't change that. So you can get angry all you want about that situation, but you're not going to change it. In fact, your anger is going to make it worse.
Yes.
And so a lot of times, you know, we'll see these characteristics in us. And if we're going to live our life saying, "Well, they made me do that," or "She made me do that," or "He made me do that," or, you know, "I wouldn't have put my fist through the wall if he hadn't done this," or "She hadn't done that."
Right.
"I wouldn't have kicked the side of the car in it," you know, whatever. You know, whatever the reason. It's not that person. It's not that thing. It's you.
Yes.
Right.
You're not living in peace. You're not living in rest. You're not walking in his path. You know? And so, you know, all of these, you know, sometimes the devil will make temptations, tests, and trials. Life is full of temptations, tests, and trials.
Right.
You know, but God is never in an evil test, never in an evil trial. The Bible says if you believe that, you're in error,
yes,
says in James.
Yep.
But there's times we need to see who we really are.
Mm-hmm.
And we need to see how we really need to depend on him to get us out of that situation and change that in our lives. Because if you could have changed it, you would have done it a long time ago.
Right.
But you can't. Mm-hmm. And so you need to let God work in you who you are.
Amen.
You need to let God show you who you are.
Yes.
Quit believing all of this other stuff and let God show you who you are.
Yeah.
I tell you, you'll act different, you'll walk different, you'll talk different,
right,
you'll treat people different,
yeah,
when you find out who you are.
Yeah.
He's got a path. He prepared it before the foundations of the earth. You are his workmanship in Christ Jesus. You have a functioning part that you give your supply to. And God knows what that is, but you got to find out from him, not people.
Right.
of things.
Yep.
You got to find out who he says you are. That this back over to, you know, Ephesians. Go back over to Ephesians 2, and I'm going to close.
Thank you, Lord.
And Mike and Pastor have touched on this several times. But here in chapter 2, verse 1, it says, "And you he made alive, who were dead in trespasses and sins, in which you once walked." I like that. Once walked. Not going to walk there again if I can help it. "Once walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience, among whom also we are all once conducted ourselves in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, just as others. But God," I love that, "but God, who is rich in mercy, because of his great love which he loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised up together, and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us in Christ Jesus.
Yes.
For by grace you have been saved through faith, and not of yourselves. It is a gift of God, the gift of God. Not of works, lest anyone should boast, but we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which he has prepared beforehand that we should walk in them."
Amen. That's
God's
the truth.
Got good works for you to watch.
Yes.
And he's got all the provision already taken care of. It's like those marathon race runners running the race. There's stations along the way with protein bars and energy drinks and water and all the things they need. It's prepared along the way. It's prepared along the way. There's words and tidbits and nuggets of revelation along the way to get you through the next situation. To make sure that you stay on that path. Don't go seeking wisdom from men. You seek it from the one who knows the path, because he made it. Amen? Father, I thank you and I praise you tonight. Father God, I thank you that we learn to walk in your ways. We learn, Father God, to be who you called us to be. Not who Mama said we were, or our school teacher, or whoever. That God, who you said, because you've known before the foundation of the earth who we are.
Yes.
You called us by name. You know our name. You know our address. You put us exactly where you want us to be, Father.
Yep.
And Father, I thank you and I praise you.
Thank
you. That you knew beforehand what we would need. And God, you have seen to it in Christ Jesus that we have everything we need along the path. So, Father, we just praise you and we thank you tonight. Father, I pray for those who have been tormented in their mind and in their souls, Father God, the last few weeks. I just sense real strong that there's just been a torment that's gone on in the souls of people. Father, I thank you and I praise you. I declare your peace right now into that matter. I declare your word. I declare your revelation and illumination in that place of darkness. I say you will not stay in that place of darkness, but I speak light into that realm right now. And Father God, I thank you that that light is there to disinfect everything that the enemy has tried to infect your people with. We thank you for the light of God that shines in their hearts and their minds right now in Jesus' name. We loosed you from the harassing captivity that you've been held in Jesus' name. We say you be free in the name of Jesus Christ. We command every lying spirit that has tormented, that has held captive, and held you in a place that you seem like you can't move forward. In the name of Jesus Christ, I say you're free to move forward. And we say that every step this week is a step out of that darkness and into the light that God has for you. Father God, I thank you and I praise you that your peace and your rest and your light and illumination and revelation come into the hearts and the minds of your people. And Father God, I thank you and praise you that they begin to see the proverbial light at the end of the tunnel, Father God. And Father, that God, they run toward that because that is your love, that is your warmth, and that is your security. That is your safety. We thank you and we praise you, Father God, for moving and working in the hearts of your people. God, we are a victorious people because you said we were in Genesis 1. You said we were blessed. You said we had dominion. You said, Father God, that we have authority over any creep on the face of this earth, and there's no bigger creep than the devil. So, Father God, we thank you and we praise you. We put him under our feet tonight. We put a stop to his creeping. In Jesus' name, the hearts and the minds of the people of God. And Father God, we thank you and we praise you that we find that stream. We find that stream in the desert. Thank you, Father. We find that path in the wilderness because you ordained it. And we bless you and we honor you in Jesus' name. Praise God.